The rapture is a controversial topic, and in the past few decades, most of that controversy has centered around pre, mid, post. Will Jesus take us away before or in the middle or after the Great Tribulation? But the emphasis is now shifting, and there is a growing movement within the Church of Jesus Christ that says there will be no rapture at all. In fact, the big controversy, I believe, that lies just ahead of us will be rapture or no rapture. There are people who believe that we must establish the kingdom before Jesus can return, and he will not return to take us away, but he will return to rule over the kingdom that we have set up for him. I think it's a heavy delusion. I think it's very important that we understand the kingdom, dominion, restoration movements, and we want to deal with that in this next session. Let's open our Bibles again this evening to Genesis 1. We're going to go back there again. Genesis 1:26, a verse we've referred to several times. And God said, "Let us make man in our image, after our likeness." You know, it says that in the Quran. Are you aware of that? I've asked Islamic scholars, who's this we, let us, our, you know, Allah is one single individual. They can't tell you. This is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit speaking. Let us make man in our image after our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. There's a word in this verse that has come to prominence recently, and you're going to hear more about it. Dominion. I have here an advertisement for Dominion Press. Now, what kind of books do you think they turn out? And they're quoting verse 28. And God blessed them, and God said unto them, "Be fruitful, and multiply, and replenish the earth, and subdue it, and have dominion." And the book specifically that they are advertising is called Paradise Restored. Paradise Restored by David Chilton. He's a very brilliant young man, writer. A Biblical Theology of Dominion. Now, what do you suppose that could possibly mean? Maybe some of you are puzzled by this. You're going to hear more about this sort of thing. What he talks about in part in here is how we're going to raise children to rule this world, to take dominion. I have another ad attached here from, now that's not a well-known publisher, Dominion Press. You wouldn't recognize them. But here's one from a very well-known and a very highly regarded evangelical publisher. They're putting out a series, the Biblical Blueprint Series. And let me just read a little bit of it. An agenda for victory. A new vision has captured the imaginations of a growing army of registered voters. This new vision is simple. It's the old vision of Genesis 1, 27 and 28. Here we go again. Dominion. And Matthew 28, 19 through 20. Now that's the Great Commission. It's called Dominion. For the first time in over 300 years, a growing number of Christians are starting to view themselves as an army on the move. This army will grow. This series is designed to help it grow and grow tougher. The authors of this series are determined to set the agenda in world affairs for the next few centuries. Now you would stop right there and say, for the next few centuries. Doesn't sound like they're expecting the Lord to come. Robert Schuller says his new reformation is going to set things up for the next millennium. Doesn't sound like he's expecting the imminent return of Jesus Christ. Well, you're not entirely right when you come to that conclusion. Some of these people expect the Lord to return very soon, some of them not so soon. But one thing that they all have in common is that they don't believe in the rapture. The rapture used to be the great hope of the church. Well, we had an argument. Is it going to be pre-trib rapture, or mid-trib rapture, or post-trib rapture? But at least we believed in the rapture. But there is a new movement that is growing very rapidly within the Church of Jesus Christ of people who do not believe in the rapture at all. Now, sometimes they give mixed signals, and sometimes it's not easy to understand exactly what they're saying. Let me give you an example of someone who I think is kind of on the fence, but sometimes he sounds like he does not believe in the rapture at all, but at other times he protests that he does, but I'm not sure what kind of a rapture he believes in. This was a talk given December 9th, 1984 by Pat Robertson. I'm not quoting it verbatim, but basically he said, I want you to imagine a world without sin, without disease. The prisons are empty, there are no pornographers, they have no access to the public. Godly people are in control. In fact, Christians have taken control of this world. There's no demon possession. We have a spirit-filled man in the White House. He said the Congress and the Senate are the same, the judges are spirit-filled, the prisons are empty, and so forth. The Christians have the wealth of this world. We're in control of society. He said, you think I'm talking about the millennium. No, I'm not talking about the millennium. I mean right here and now. You mark my words, it's going to happen within 2 or 3 or 4 years. There are people who believe that we must take over the world, that Christians must take over the world, and that Jesus Christ cannot come back until this happens. One of the leaders in this movement, they just had a conference, in fact. Earl Polk is the man I'm referring to. Another one of the speakers, Oral Roberts. Another one of the speakers, Jamie Buckingham, Larry Lee, Gary North, Tommy Reed, Luther Blackwell, John Mears. And you say, well, that's guilt by association. Well, I'm not making guilt by association. Apparently, they must have something in common, or they wouldn't be all speaking together at the same conference. And they do that more than once. They wouldn't invite me to speak at the conference, I can guarantee you that. The theme of the conference in Atlanta, Georgia, at Chapel Hill Harvester Church, of which Earl Polk is the pastor, was Let My Spirit Go. And the brochure for this conference indicated that there were some things that were standing in the way. One of those things is a reluctance of leadership to embrace, this church leadership, to embrace revelation knowledge as God continues to speak to his people. I was speaking with one of the leaders, and a well-known man whose name I'm not going to mention because I'm not certain how deeply he's gotten into this. And I sat in his office and I said, brother, do you believe in the rapture? He said, I'm not sure. Well, I said, what does the Bible say? He said, well, if you ask me what the Bible says, I don't think there's any doubt about it. But there are new revelations. New revelations that supersede the Bible, that give us additional light, that change our thinking about the Word of God. And that's what this man, Earl Polk, is talking about. There is a reluctance on the part of church leadership to recognize that there are new revelations. And Earl Polk calls this book, the Bible, the milk of the Word. But the meat is the new revelation that is coming forth from the new leadership in the Church of Jesus Christ today, which we must heed. In his book, Satan Unmasked, he says on page 125 that the church, a great need for the church today is prophets, but they should not be judged. I have been accused of causing division by questioning what people are teaching and by saying, we've got to examine what everyone teaches, and that goes for me. You must examine what I teach in light of the Word of God. I've been accused of causing division. Well, we don't take time to turn to it, but in Luke 12, Jesus said, I came to bring division. He came to bring a division between light and darkness, between the truth of God and the lie of Satan. And if you will read in John's Gospel, you will find three or four times over, it, everywhere Jesus went, it says there was a division among the people because of him. Because people didn't like what he said. And they were not willing to accept the truth. But they will quote verses like, mark them which cause division among you and avoid them. That's Romans 16, verse 11. But I misquoted it. I left something very important out, which very often is left out. What does that verse really say? It says, mark them which cause division contrary to the doctrine that you have received and avoid them. You are not causing division if you are standing for the pure truth, the doctrine of the Word of God. It is those who refuse to accept it who are causing division. And we're to mark those who cause division contrary to the doctrine that we have received, and they're to be avoided. People say, touch not the Lord's anointed. I've heard that very often. Brother, you are in trouble, because you have touched the Lord's anointed. Some of the greatest Christian leaders on the face of the earth today, you have questioned their teaching. You have attempted to judge their teaching. Yes, we've already quoted it. 1 Corinthians 14:29 says, let the prophet speak. If you're a prophet, go ahead and speak. But it says, let the others judge. And if you're not willing to be judged by the Word of God, then you don't qualify as a prophet of God. Touch not the Lord's anointed. What does it mean? Well, again, we don't have time to turn to the verses. But you will find that in Psalm 105. But you will find it earlier than that. You will find it, first of all, in 1 Samuel 24. David was being hunted by Saul. And David and his men were hiding in a cave. And Saul came in, and what do you know? He came in to take a nap. And David's men whispered to him, this is the day of which the Lord has told you. He's delivered your enemy into your hands. Now smite him, and all of this will be over. And David was going to do it. He contemptuously cut off part of the skirt of Saul's robe, and then his heart smote him. And he said, God forbid that I should lift up my hand against the anointed of the Lord. To touch not the Lord's anointed means don't kill him. In the 26th chapter of 1 Samuel, you will find a similar situation where Saul is chasing David, but on both occasions, although David did not touch the Lord's anointed, which means to kill him, on both occasions he rebuked the Lord's anointed. And he rebuked him publicly in front of his army and in front of David's men. We must stand for truth. And there is a truth that I believe that is very important. And I'm not going to argue with you pre, mid, or post, or what tonight, although I feel very strongly that the pre-trib rapture fits the pieces of the puzzle together. And I will give you some reasons for that this evening. Jesus said, you know, at such an hour as you think not, the Son of Man cometh. He seems to be saying, I'm going to come at a time which if you sat down and you looked at conditions in the world around you, you would say, I don't think he's coming now. That's when I'm coming, said Jesus, when you least expect it. Well, I don't see that at the end of the Great Tribulation. Well, what else is there to look forward to? You're in the middle of Armageddon, and all flesh is about to be destroyed, and Jesus has to intervene. Furthermore, I don't think there'd be many, if any, to rapture. Because you either take the mark of the beast. If you take the mark of the beast, you suffer the wrath of the Lamb. If you don't take them, so you're not going to be raptured. If you don't take the mark of the beast, you can't buy or sell. You're killed. I don't know who there is to rapture at the end of the Great Tribulation. But there'd be very few, and it'd be a rather an anticlimax. What are you going to do? Just pick them up and bring them right back down? because we're supposed to come in the armies with Jesus, the armies of heaven, to take over this world. He said, as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the days of the Son of Man. They were eating and drinking, marrying, giving in marriage. It sounds like they're partying it up. It sounds like peace and prosperity. That was one of the themes that caused me to write that book, Peace, Prosperity, and the Coming Holocaust. The last thing they expected in Noah's day was judgment. And don't tell me this world won't expect judgment just before Jesus comes at the end of the Great Tribulation, when there's been a time of judgment already upon this earth like the world has never seen before. It doesn't fit. I could give you other reasons, but we won't go on. But you know, it's very interesting, and you may not be aware of this, that Satan already, I believe he knows, I believe Satan believes in a pre-trib rapture. I believe that he knows it's going to happen that way. And he already has four explanations for a sudden disappearance of hundreds of millions of people across this earth. And I will give you those explanations as quickly as I can. I don't know if you've ever been to a large New Age conference. I think you ought to go. You will find loving people. They are missionary-minded. They are evangelistic. They believe they're going to take over this world. They've got to solve the ecological and the political and the economic problems of this world. They're going to bring peace, love, and brotherhood, all without the Prince of Peace, all without Christ, but by looking within to this great potential that lies within all of us and realizing that we're all the Christ and attaining to this state of consciousness called Christ consciousness. And I like to witness to these people. We made a film called Pathway to Paradise, New Age Movement, Pathway to Paradise, question mark. And you can order that from Christian Information Bureau. And in the process, we went to a number of these conferences, and one of the men who was on the crew went up to an astrology booth to talk to the woman in charge of it who claimed to be a Christian. In fact, she said that she was a Sunday school superintendent. And he said, how can you possibly be a Christian and be involved in astrology? She looked at him and said to him very seriously, how can you dare not to be? Don't you know what's going to happen when the great transformation takes place? You see, the New Agers are expecting a quantum leap in the evolutionary process and a new species, Homo noeticus. I'm trying this together for you. Edgar Mitchell, mystical experience on Apollo 14, came back to Earth, abandoned the outer space program to join the inner space program, and he founded the Institute of Noetic Sciences, okay? Homo noeticus is the new species with a higher consciousness, and Edgar Mitchell and Willis Harmon and these scientists are investigating these states of consciousness in order to prepare for this. And Homo noeticus, with this quantum leap, will be a new species. You know, they say when you try to find fossil evidence for evolution, there are gaps. And suddenly a new species appears and an old species has vanished. And they say that's going to happen. And there is a species that must vanish when this new species manifests itself. And she said very seriously, don't you know, if you're not part of this great transformation when it takes place, you are going to be instantly removed to a non-physical dimension where your karma will have to catch up with you before you are allowed back on the physical plane. Yes, they are expecting a sudden mass disappearance. Now, there are a lot of people who feel that World War III must be the next thing on the agenda. Because, of course, the Antichrist couldn't possibly, some great traumatic event must take place in order for the world to accept the Antichrist. And they believe that he will arise out of the ashes of a nuclear holocaust. And the world in desperation will look to this man for leadership. I don't think so. I don't think that that's what's going to cause it. But there's a great traumatic event, and they're talking about emergence through emergency. Just suppose, whether you believe in a pre-trib rapture or not, and we've already mentioned what a tremendous moral and spiritual vacuum would be created upon this earth if it happened. But whether you believe in it or not, supposing for a moment that several hundred million people vanished from planet Earth, and supposing you were left behind and you saw lots of them vanish, that's going to do something, I'll tell you. You're thinking about a transformation of consciousness. You're going to have a transformation of consciousness. You have just seen an event that you can't believe. It's not possible, but it happened before your very eyes and before the eyes of the world. And I can see the United Nations leaders meeting, night after night. What has happened in computers bringing in, trying to correlate this data? But an explanation comes forth. Well, I'll give you another explanation. There are a number of these explanations. I've talked to UFO cultists. They're in communication with the Space Brothers, you know, who run the UFOs. And they have communications with them. And you know what these entities have told them? When we take over this world, for your good, of course, and impose our new order in order to bring peace, all those who are not willing to be part of our new order will be instantly beamed aboard UFOs and taken off to a space planet where they're going to be reprogrammed before they're allowed back on planet Earth. They're expecting a sudden mass disappearance also. Well, there's a great move now for unity in the world. It's called the World Instant of Cooperation, tied in with the first Earth run. And they're going to go into meditation December 31st, 1986. They also are saying, this meditation, you understand, I think we've talked about this before, that this universal consciousness of Carl Jung, this universal mind, we are all part of God. So if we can get a critical mass of people, enough people thinking positive thoughts, that's God thinking, that's the universal mind thinking, you see. We've tipped the balance in the scale in the masses of those who are part of the universal mind, and we will bring about peace. We will bring about a transformation. Some of you have seen the little sign that says, visualize world peace. And they say all those who are not part of this great transformation are going to be removed from this earth. But the ones that we're talking about this evening and that we're primarily concerned about, these are Christian people. I'm not saying they're not Christians. I don't know their heart, but they're professing Christians, and often they seem to preach the gospel. That's what makes it confusing. There's a confusing mixture of truth and error. And they also are expecting a mass disappearance of people. And they take the verses in Matthew 24 where it says, two will be grinding at the mill, one will be taken, the other will be left. Two will be sleeping in a bed, or two will be working in a field, one will be taken, the other left. And they say, do you want to know who these people are who are going to be instantly removed? That's not the rapture, folks. These are the carnal Christians who are holding back this great move of God, who will be instantly removed so we can get on with this program. God is going to take them away to judgment. Now, you notice a common denominator in all four cases. It's the bad people who go. Why do you think that must be? Because you can't have people left on this earth wishing they had gone. You can't have people left on this earth wringing their hands and saying, it's the rapture, we've been left behind, we better get with it and believe Jesus. Well, we've already referred to the scriptures that says those who refuse the love of the truth will be given a strong delusion to believe the lie. And I think I've already said to you, if you were the only person left here and everybody else vanished from this room, you would not believe it was the rapture. I guarantee you. I think the United States is unique. It would probably be destroyed. It would be the end of the United States. I think we would become a satellite of not the Soviet Union, but of NATO. Because although probably 80 to 100 million would vanish from China, more than from the United States for sure, they're mostly coolies, they're street sweepers, they're nobodies. It's not going to disrupt their society. The same in Africa. Probably 100 million would vanish. But it'd just be that much more food and jobs to go around. Europe the same. I guarantee you NATO would be intact. There are not many Christians in high positions, but in the United States we're unique. I don't think we have the 50 million voters born again in the United States, or our society would not be going downhill morally as it is. But I think we've got millions and millions, and it could be that President Reagan himself is a Christian, on down through the cabinet, generals, admirals, colonels, fighter pilots, computer operators, congressmen, senators, all through our society. Suddenly, we have collapsed as a major power. And you say that's just what the Soviet Union is waiting for. Yes, but probably as many have vanished from the Soviet Union. And they've got their own problems. But there's a uniqueness about the Soviet Union. They are paranoid about keeping track of their citizens. They wouldn't believe it was the rapture. Somebody left the borders open. Somehow they've sneaked a mass of people out of here. How in the world could they do that? And they're too busy with their own problems. There's consternation in the Kremlin trying to understand what's going on to attack us. But listen, it's the bad people who have gone in every case. And those of us who are left behind, we are part of the greatest event in the history of mankind. Truly, this is the dawning of a new age. We've taken an evolutionary leap, a quantum leap. There's a transformation of consciousness. Satan's power is unleashed with all deceivableness. And something has happened to the thinking of everyone on planet Earth. And out of this arises a man who is the new leader. A new unity, a new sense of belonging to one another, a planetary consciousness, a new sense of being members of something, the same race, and there's an excitement. And you'd be happy to have a mark on your hand or on your forehead and know that Big Brother's looking after you. You wouldn't want to disappear. You wouldn't want to miss out on what lies ahead, the dawning of a new age. I'm very concerned about this. We have lost the hope of heaven in the Church of Jesus Christ today. Oh, they contemptuously call it pie in the sky in the sweet by and by. And I was just looking in the hymn book, thinking of some of the hymns. You want to know what the church has always believed? Go back and see the hymns that they've sung. You remember that favorite, "When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound and time shall be no more, and the morning breaks eternal, bright and fair. When the saved of earth shall gather in," you know, somewhere on this earth, in the kingdom that we've established? No. "When the saved of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there." That's what we've talked about. But Earl Polk calls the rapture an escape theory. And in one of his books, titled "Held in the Heavens Until," he says, Jesus is held in the heavens. He can't come back until we've taken over the world, and he will not come back to rapture us, but he will come back to reign over the kingdom that we've established. Now you can see the problem. If we are a heavenly people, Philippians chapter 3, our citizenship is in heaven, from whence also we wait for the Savior, who will change our vile bodies, that they may be transformed to be like his body of glory. Something's going to happen to our bodies to equip us, to fit us for this heavenly realm. What did Jesus say in John 14? "In my Father's house are many mansions." He said, "I am going away. You will have sorrow. You will see me no more. But I want you to know that I'm going away to prepare a place for you. And if I go away, I will come again to receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also." You all know 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. "The Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, the trump of God. The dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them to meet the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord." Now, if the real Jesus is going to catch us up and meet us in the air, and you are looking forward to meeting a Jesus who, when you meet him, your feet are planted on planet Earth, and he simply has arrived to take over the kingdom you've established for him, you have been laboring under heavy, heavy delusion. Not only that, you have been working for the kingdom of the Antichrist, who will not be an obviously evil ogre with horns. He's going to be a man of peace, love, and brotherhood, who's going to establish unity on this earth as never before. Of course, it's going to fall apart at the seams, but not immediately. Why was Hitler able to deceive even the born-again fundamentalist Christians in the 30s in Nazi Germany? Because he was for all of the right things. He was for law and order. He was for peace. He brought prosperity. He was for cleaning up crime. And they thought he was God's man of the hour. Indeed, he said, Hitler said, National Socialism is, and notice his terminology, positive Christianity. I'm quoting him verbatim. Positive Christianity is what Hitler preached. And he said that he had been ordained by Providence to establish the kingdom upon this earth, and for 1,000 years, representatives from all over the world would come to Nuremberg to remember this great event. And many born-again Christians believed this, and it was too late before they realized that he was the nearest thing to the Antichrist that the world has ever seen. Now, why does this word dominion intrigue people so? I don't know. I don't understand it. Let's just take a very quick look at it and go back and see. Dominion over what? Dominion, verse 26, over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. It doesn't say that we're going to have dominion over one another. It doesn't say we're going to take dominion over the non-Christians. It doesn't say we're going to take over the kingdoms of this world and establish the kingdom of God. It doesn't say that at all. And these men are teaching that the great need of the hour is to take dominion. Now, there are three things about dominion that they have misunderstood. First of all, it doesn't mean that we're gods, but they say that's what it means. Now, let me quote Earl Polk, who says, Adam and Eve were placed in the world as the seed and expression of God. Just as dogs have puppies and cats have kittens, so God has little gods. Until we comprehend that we are little gods and we begin to act like little gods, we cannot manifest the kingdom of God. That's not true. You don't have to be a little god to have dominion. We've talked about that, so we won't go back over that again. Dominion doesn't mean that we're little gods. Furthermore, we haven't lost dominion. Have we lost dominion over the fish of the sea and the fowls of the air and the creeping things? You swat mosquitoes, you spray those bugs in your garden, you go out and shoot your deer, and you kill your chickens, and you eat fish. We have not lost dominion. There is a basic misunderstanding here. The problem is we have dominion. We have dominion, and we have destroyed this world because we have been running it. That's the problem. But they're not willing to admit that, and they're going to say what we need to do is take it over and really run it. No, the king must come to establish his kingdom. But they say that we're going to manifest immortality in these bodies. That Christians must get beyond susceptibility to disease, to any sickness, and we must manifest immortality in these bodies. Now, of course, that's a logical extension of the positive confession teaching of men like Kenneth Hagin and Kenneth Copeland and others. After all, if you can have what you say, and if you can, as Paul Yonggi Cho says, make things happen by visualizing them, then what we ought to do is make a positive confession for the whole world. We ought to confess healing. We ought to confess prosperity. We ought to confess blessing. And all the Christians ought to get together and make this positive confession for the world and bring peace, prosperity, blessing, the end of disease, the end of everything. That is what they would call negative. And return this earth to a paradisical state. It's not going to happen. It's not biblical. The Bible tells us specifically, and again, we don't take time to turn to it, but you know these verses. 2 Peter chapter 3, what does it say? This world that was once destroyed by the flood is now held in reserve for fire. It is going to be destroyed by fire. Not just this earth and all the works in it will be burned up, but the very heavens will be rolled up like a scroll. And the elements themselves will melt with the fervent heat. You see, the kingdom of God is not the millennium. Now, the Jehovah's Witnesses have made that mistake. And I like to remind the Jehovah's Witnesses of a number of things about the kingdom. The Word of God distinctly tells us, "Thy kingdom is an everlasting kingdom." You get that in Psalm 145. Even Nebuchadnezzar knew that. You get that in chapters 4 and chapter 7 of Daniel. Isaiah 9:6, that verse that we know so well, that we quote each Christmas particularly, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. And the government will be upon his shoulders, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father." And then what does the next verse say? "And of his kingdom and peace there will be no end." No end. How does the millennium end? It ends with the greatest war the world has ever seen. Satan is released. He deceives the nations and they march upon Jerusalem. You can't believe it. Jesus himself has reigned over this earth. The lion lies down with the lamb. He has brought peace to this earth. It is not the kingdom of God. It is the final proof of the incorrigible nature of the human heart. And there is no hope except we deny self and take up the cross and follow Jesus Christ. The kingdom of God involves a new heavens and a new earth. And that new universe is only to be inhabited by those who have been willing to become new creatures in Christ Jesus, who have allowed Jesus Christ to take over and make them new. And old things have passed away. All things have become new. They look to him and to him alone to be their life, to be their all. Now, it's becoming very popular today to say that what we really need, not so much the preaching of the cross, which is foolishness to those that perish, what we really need is signs and wonders. We need miracles. We need healings. I'm not against signs and wonders, but I'm against those things that pretend to be signs and wonders that are not signs and wonders. I'm against seminars that pretend to tell you how to perform miracles. I'm concerned about people who have hands laid on them, and someone talks in tongues or says they're talking in tongues and says, "You repeat after me." Oh, you got it. You say a few syllables. Now go home and practice your prayer language. You might as well practice walking on water or raising the dead. If this is a miraculous power from God, you don't get it by practicing it. You don't get it by initiating it. It's the same idea as visualization or whatever it may be. It's something I'm going to bring about by techniques or however. And those who role model miracles and who say, "Step out and just follow the way I'm doing it," and would tell you, "Now look for hot spots and check some auras, and you can tell how the spirit is working in a person depending upon how their eyelids are fluttering, or they may become hysterical, or their breathing becomes accelerated or whatever." They have a theology of healing based upon experience, not based upon the Word of God. But there is a growing belief that we've got to have signs and wonders. Oral Roberts, for example, has founded a new organization called CBM, is the initials, Charismatic Bible Ministries. And they stand firmly for signs and wonders, and they declare that the gospel is not thoroughly preached without signs and wonders being manifest. Well, then Moody didn't preach the gospel, and Finney and Spurgeon didn't preach the gospel, and Jimmy Swaggart doesn't preach the gospel, and Billy Graham doesn't preach the gospel fully. But neither does Oral Roberts, because signs and wonders are lacking in his ministry also. I don't know if you're familiar with it, but Health Magazine, for example, made an investigation of healing, miraculous healing across America. And they sent a team to City of Faith in Tulsa. Why go to City of Faith? Well, it ought to be the first place you would go to if you wanted to check out miracles, because it was built specifically at the command of a 900-foot Jesus who told Oral Roberts that if everyone on his mailing list would send in $240, and they built a $150 million healing center, that there would be a cure for cancer and so forth. You know what the people from Health Magazine, they were shocked. They went there expecting evidence of miracles, I'm quoting from Health Magazine. Surprisingly, however, City of Faith hospital spokesmen have no faith healing statistics to offer and are even unwilling to say that combining prayer with medicine cures more frequently or hastens healing any more quickly than medicine itself. Christians gave over $150 million to put up this miracle center, and they say there are no miracles, no more miracles here than any ordinary hospital. Dewey Jernigan, director of Oral Roberts City of Faith Prayer Partner Ministry, has admitted, quote, there are no more miracles at the City of Faith than in any other hospital. That may be why one of the benefits that CBM, Charismatic Bible Ministries, offers to its members who stand solidly for signs and wonders and healing, and no Christian should ever be sick. One of the benefits, strangely enough, that is being offered by Charismatic Bible Ministries to its members is health and accident and hospital insurance. I find that a little bit contradictory. I don't want to make fun of these people. God forbid that we should do that. I believe they are very sincere and they love the Lord. But I believe that they have misunderstood and misapplied the Word of God. Kenneth Hagin, for example, quotes the prayer of Jesus. He taught his disciples to pray, Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And he says, well, what is God's will in heaven? And he says, you can bind out of this earth whatever is bound in heaven. Well, what is bound in heaven? Sickness and disease and death is not in heaven. And what is in heaven? Prosperity and health and so forth. Well, we can have it here. But he forgets one little phrase. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done. Thy kingdom come. The will of God will be done on this earth as it is in heaven only when his kingdom comes. And we will not establish it. It will only be when the king himself is here. And if Jesus himself, taking 1,000 years of his own personal reign on this earth, cannot establish the kingdom, the real kingdom on this earth, but that 1,000 years ends with the greatest battle the world has ever seen, then what makes us think that we can establish it even without him here yet? The Bible is very, very clear. Then shall that enemy be destroyed. When? 1 John chapter 3. Beloved, now are we the sons of God. It doth not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, then we shall be like him. Then shall be brought to pass, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, that which was spoken, death, where is your victory? Death is swallowed up in victory. Death, where is your sting? Grave, where is your victory? Death is swallowed up in victory. When? When the trumpet sounds and the dead are raised and we are caught up and our bodies are changed. And they will not be changed until then. And if we go against the Word of God, then we're in danger of great deception. Now, one of the major problems that we want to point out is it's not only the manifested sons of God, the kingdom dominion, the restoration, the reconstructionists who are working together now who believe this, but there are many non-Christians out there who sense the same thing, who are working together for a new world, politically, economically. And I've already gone on record a number of times saying I believe Christians, we ought to take advantage of our voting rights. We ought to stand for truth. We ought to stand for righteousness. We ought to be against abortion and pornography and these things every way that we lawfully can. But I don't believe Christians should join with Mormons and Moonies and occultists in opposing these things and say, well, at least they're for morals, you know, so let's join together. We should stand as Christians and we should stand for righteousness and against sin on the principles of the Word of God and as Christians, not joining in with others. But that sort of thing is being done today, and there's a growing movement out there for Christians to get involved with others. Here's a letter that went out to pastors. We're welcoming you, and you can understand who it came from. We're welcoming you to participate wholeheartedly in the new age government of this country. God's master plan, the evolution of the divine race, has shifted into a new phase. Mass consciousness is being activated. We're moving into an age of inspiration, of mass revelation. Truly, the Spirit is being poured out upon the people in these days. Well, you know that it's not the Holy Spirit. that's being poured out. It's another spirit. You who have led your flocks this far, being called now to drop all apparent differences and come together under the banner of peace. It's very difficult to resist this. We need peace. We're trembling under a nuclear sword of Damocles. Shouldn't we unite together? The Pope has been out there calling for peace. He just had a gathering in Italy. And there were representatives from 60 religions that came there together. But the Pope has been stumping around the world. And I'm sure you've seen some of the news articles. Here's an article in a Jewish paper. And it says, 2,000 years of history change with Pope's visit to synagogue. Here's a news article. The Pope is visiting the Dalai Lama. And the Pope in New Delhi talks with the Dalai Lama. And he says that to work for the attainment and preservation of all human rights, including the basic right to worship God, this is what we're going to do. But the pontiff called for collaboration among the world's religions. What kind of a collaboration? Here is the Pope with a Muslim. The Pope has been wooing the leaders of the religions of this world. In India, the Pope said, I have come here. He says, India has so much to offer to the world in the task of understanding man and the truth of his existence. She offers a noble spiritual vision of man. The vision of man that India offers is a Hindu vision of man as a god. In fact, he is God. And the goal is to realize this through yoga. And he said, he came to India and he said, we have come here to learn from your great spiritual tradition. There is a lowering of standards by men, not only the Pope, but by others that we have looked to as leaders. Oral Roberts was recently being interviewed, and I hope I can find it. I carry so many things up here, and then I can never find what I've got. He was being interviewed on the Phil Donahue show, and I don't know if you heard it, but Phil Donahue tried to get Oral Roberts to commit himself to what happens to people who don't receive Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord. He wouldn't do it. Finally, after he's waffled around a bit, Phil Donahue says, let's talk about specifics. Oral, one more time, and we promise we'll make this brief. Do Jews go to heaven? Roberts, I certainly believe they do. Donahue, now they have not accepted Jesus Christ as their personal Savior. Oral Roberts, how do you know? Phil Donahue, do they have to in order to go to heaven? Oral Roberts, I don't have to answer that question because I'm not God. I'm not the judge of the Jews. I'm not the judge of anybody. God is the judge. There's a man who is compromising. There's a man who is avoiding the truth, avoiding the issues. I believe that we ought to take advantage of the voting rights that God has given us in this wonderful country. But I don't think Christians have a mandate from God to take dominion over the United States and to take over this world. And you know, some of the anti-Christians out there, some of the humanists, are recognizing that that is indeed the intention of Christians. They're going to take over and they're going to impose this standard upon others. There's a coming one world government. We can't escape that. And there's a coming one world religion as well. And Revelation 13, again, we don't take time to turn to it, but it tells us that there's a man who will be worshipped as God. You'll get it in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 4. He will be worshipped as God. There's a new world religion coming. I believe we're in the preparation stages of that right now. The world is being set up, and I'm very concerned that the lies that set the stage for this are not only out there in the world, but they're inside the Church of Jesus Christ. Gary North, one of the leaders in the Reconstruction movement, calls the rapture theory an eschatology of defeat. I think he misunderstands victory and defeat. I love these old hymns, and one of them says of Jesus, "By weakness and defeat, he won the victor's crown. Tread all his foes beneath his feet by being trodden down." He said to Pilate, who said to him, "What is truth?" Jesus said, "I came to bear witness of the truth." And he said contemptuously, "What is truth?" Pilate said, "You're a king, are you?" And Jesus said, "Yes, I'm a king. But I came to bear witness to the truth. And I want you to know, Pilate, my kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, then would my servants fight, that I should not be delivered to the Jews, but my kingdom is not from hence." There is a victory that comes through the way of the cross, that does not come by force of arms, that does not come by taking up a crusade, as the crusaders did, and going to wrest Jerusalem out of the hands of the infidels and killing all kinds of innocent people in the process. There is a victory that comes through submission to the lordship of Jesus Christ and following in the way of the cross that leads home. Jimmy Swaggart recently said, "Let's take a look at the name it and claim it philosophy." Just the other day, a dear pastor told me of a prominent brother in his church, incidentally a man with whom I'm acquainted, who watched his daughter die because of this unscriptural philosophy. He had been taught by some of the men you've named, he's replying to someone, and have defended that if we pray for someone's healing and then confess that the individual is healed, there is no way that person cannot be healed. Consequently, we should not confess that they are sick, neither should we seek the help of a doctor if a healing has not come, but should continue to confess the healing. The poor brother continued to confess the healing. The little girl died. He sat with head and hands out of his mind, telling his pastor, "I killed my baby." It happens again and again. We will not be delivered from all disease, and every person who has ever taught that healing is in the atonement and that means, therefore, that no Christian should ever sicken and die on this earth, they are all dead or they are dying. And none of them who have taught this has been able to manifest that belief even extends your life, even to 100 or 120 or 150 years. Because God has something better than perpetuating us in these bodies of disease and decay and sin. He has a new universe for us. That's His kingdom. And we are a heavenly people. And we must not be ashamed to say, "I'm looking to be with Him, to join Him in the mansions in the sky, in His Father's house, where there are many mansions." I want to just close to show you the contrast between what is being taught today and what men of God have believed in the past. Here was the climax of a sermon by that prince of preachers, Charles Haddon Spurgeon, in the Metropolitan Tabernacle in London, about 100 years ago. He said, "Do you think we love God for what we get out of Him and for nothing else? Is that your notion of a Christian's love to God? This is how the ungodly talk. And that is what the devil thought was Job's case. Says he, 'Does Job fear God for naught? Hast thou not set a hedge about him and all that he has?' The devil does not understand real love and affection. But the child of God can tell the devil to his face that he loves God if he covers him with sores and sets him on the dunghill. And by God's good help, he means to cling to God through troubles tenfold heavier than those he has had to bear, should they come upon him. Is he not a blessed God? Aye, let the beds of our sickness ring with it. He is a blessed God. In the night watches when we are weary, and our brain is hot and fevered, and our soul is distracted, we yet confess that he is a blessed God." Every ward of the hospital where believers are found should echo with that note. "A blessed God? Aye, that he is," say the poor and needy here this morning, and so say all God's poor throughout all the land. "A blessed God? I say his dying people, as he slays us, Job said, 'Though he slay me, yet will I trust him.' as he slays us. We are slain for his sake all the day long. We've got to be willing to die. We overcome through the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. We love not our lives unto death. Though he slay us, he says, we will bless his name. He loves us, and we love him. And though all his waves go over us, and his wrath lieth sore upon us, we would not change with kings on their thrones if they are without the love of God. We are committed to him. We are committed to his kingdom, an eternal kingdom. Those old hymns again, now none but Christ can satisfy, none other name but this. There's love and life and lasting joy, Lord Jesus, found in thee. I tried the broken cisterns, Lord, but all the waters failed. E'en as I stooped to drink, they fled and mocked me as I wailed. Now none but Christ can satisfy. We've been trying in this series to point out that Satan, from the very beginning, since the Garden of Eden, has tried to substitute man's potential for God's grace, tried to turn us into little gods, tried to tell us that we have the capability within ourselves, tried to turn us from the true God to false idols, tried to turn us from the fountain of living waters to the broken cisterns that cannot hold water, tried to turn us to that which cannot solve the problem. And it concerns me greatly that not only is the world attempting to do this, but we as Christians are joining with them. And we're going to find some means whereby we can take over this world and dress it up and clean it up and turn it back into a paradise without the king returning. And we have the audacity to think we will present to him a world that is purged and that is fit for his return. No, he's going to rescue. He said, except those days be shortened, no flesh would survive. And we need to cry out for him to return, Lord Jesus, to rescue this world, to rescue your people. And we long to be with him. We long to be like him. But we also have a great concern for this world and for those about us. And I hope that what we've been speaking about will help you to understand a little better some of the deception, some of the lies, some of the false ideas that are deluding people out there, so that you can be an instrument in his hand to open their eyes, turn them from darkness to light, from the power of Satan to God, and that you and I together will be able to deliver as many as we possibly can before it is too late. God bless you.